We're going to talk about electrical problems on your model railroad and what causes it and how to fix those problems. So let's get going with this right now. I'm Tom Kovichak, and this is Tom's Trains and Things. This channel was created to help other modelers like you who are in need of guidance in pursuing their dream of building a model railroad. And a lot of people have been writing to me in the past 2 months about their problems with conductivity and their wiring on their layout. I've determined that most of the problems that everybody was having was through their connectors. It could be that they are not using their connectors the way they should be. So I'm going to show you the connectors that I have here, some of the ones that I use, and I have some that I won't use anymore, and I'll tell you why. And basically, it's this kind right here. And I think this is the kind that everybody's having the problem with, the suitcase connectors. And I'm going to show you other connectors like wire nuts and these little deals right here. I'm not exactly sure what they're called, but they were originally made for fluorescent fixtures where you could use on your layout also. And these ones right here, they come in 2, 3, or 4 conductors. Terminal strips, the screw type, and where you tighten the screw down on the wire. Terminals that you use on the screw type terminals. This is a little red spade connector, 18 to 22 gauge, I think it is. And if you have any circuit boards or breadboards that you want to use on there, you've seen me use these on another project. You have a screw on the top that tightens down on the wire inside. So we're going to talk about those, and I'm going to show you how to use those properly. So let's get going with this right now. Since most of the issues have been coming from these suitcase connectors, I'm going to cover these first. And the reason I don't like these is, as you could see down into the hole, you have a large hole in here. And if you're using two different wire sizes, say you're using a 14 gauge for your bus wire, and you're using maybe a 22 gauge or an 18 gauge for your feeder wires, those have two different diameters in there. And when you press down on this blade that's on here to make contact with your 14 gauge wire, it may not always hit that 18 or 20 or even 22 gauge wire. These were originally used in the automotive industry to splice in on your cables using the same size wires. Now, that is why these aren't that good using two different wire sizes. Now, I don't have a tool for it, but they do make a tool for crimping this. But I use my channel locks. And as you could see, now I'll put it on this side where you could see that. And I'll crimp down on that. All right. Now, even though there's a little slot inside there for the wire, you don't always hit that. And your wire may be smaller than that little slot in there and not penetrate the insulation on your wire all the way. So when that happens, you don't have conductivity. And once you close this up and you forget about it and go on to the next one and the next one, as you're running your feeder wires down your layout, and then you try starting it up and you don't have any DCC signal going to your tracks, or you have bad DCC signals. This is the reason why, because in that little slot right there, and let me see if I can get any closer with that, right in here, in this one right here, it's slotted, but that may not penetrate the insulation, or it may just barely penetrate the insulation on there and not make good contact on your feeder wire. Now they make these in different sizes. Now this one, the red one right here, and this is 18 to 22 gauge wire. Now, as you can see, this is a lot smaller than the blue one. Now the blue one is probably 14 and 16 gauge wire if it uses the same color standards as everything else. Like I said, if you're using 14 gauge wire and you're using a lot smaller wire on your feeder wires, it may not penetrate the insulation. I'm going to take a picture of this and pull out one of these blades on here so you can see it better. And I'll put the picture right up here so you can see the slot in there compared to the wires. And that's why you'll have bad conductivity on your layout. The next connector I'm going to show you is originally made for fluorescent fixtures. And I wish I had these when I had to change the ballast on many, many light fixtures, but they didn't come out with these until later on. But what I use it for is for my bus wires. If I have a section of my layout that I know that I'm going to be taking apart, I'll use this as the connection between it. And you could only put this in one way because it's slotted and it has a ridge on the one side. And you put your wires in there and you're good to go. And if you ever have to move it, this would be good on a modular layout where you're taking it apart. You could use these on here and just put it in there for your bus wire. Now, there's another type that I use, similar principle, where you push it in on a contact, and that is these right here. Now, I also use this hooking up my bus wire to my feeder wires, and if I am using stranded feeder wires, I solder maybe three or four of them together. I only use these where I have multiple wires that I need to put together, like near a turnout or in a yard where I have multiple tracks together. Now these will go in just as easily on your bus wire. It just pushes right in and you're good to go. Now they say on this type right here that they're reusable. All you have to do is twist them like this. And it may take some doing, but you could take it right back out and use it over again. Now, the only problem with that is if you do that more than a couple of times, you might lose the spring action in there. It's just a little piece of metal that's down there on an angle. And as you put your wire in, it catches it. Now, when you're twisting it around, pulling it out, you may bend that back up and you may cause it to be wider than what it originally was. So I mean, these are pretty cheap and I would recommend only using them once, but you could use them in multiple size wires. Like I said, this is made for solid wire, either one of them. And it'll take a large wire and it'll take small wires. The only thing with the smaller wires, you have to be careful with it. What I do is on the smaller wires, if it's not solid wire, and if it's too small. Now a 20 gauge, and I don't have any 20 gauge right here, but what I would recommend is on a smaller wire, especially on a stranded wire, is to tin the end of it and stick it in like that. And like I said, when I use it on the stranded wire, I usually put maybe two or three together, and I'll show you a picture of what I have over here for this type of connector. But these are good connectors for running your bus wire and feeder wires. You have a real good connection in there and they work excellent. Wire nuts come in all different sizes. Here's orange and a yellow, and depending on the manufacturer, If you stick with one manufacturer, you know the color codes on them, but you could use this in solid wire and stranded wire. Solid wire works better, but you could also use it on stranded wire. So whoever you talk to, they're either going to tell you that you could leave them straight like that or start out twisting it. Make sure your insulation on each one of the wire is cut close to what the other wires are at the same length, and put the wire nut on there and twist. Now, some manufacturers put wings on it to make it a little bit easier, like on this yellow one here, and you'll see why whenever you're tightening down on some of the wires, and you'll actually need these little wings on there to get them tight. But just from tightening them like this would be enough to have a good connection on there. They're not going to go anywhere. On this type of terminal strip right here is where you tighten down the screw on your wire. Now you put one on each, you could put one on each side, or you could, if your wires are small enough, you could put a couple of them, say like if you want a jumper from one to another, you could put multiple wires on there. But all you do is you strip it down as far enough. What I normally do is measure the distance to the center of it, strip it that far, and then just put it in, and all you do is tighten down on them and you're good to go on there. Now these come in different sizes. This is a smaller one. It's a European size, and the ones that are made in North America, they're a little bit bigger, and I'll show you a comparison right here. You could hook up your bus wires on here. You could even hook up your wires going to your switch machines or anything else on your layout on here. As far as the feeder wires go, you can take them and cut these down and use these on your for your feeder wires too. You could run your bus wires through here and then put your feeder wire on the terminal on one side or on both sides. Now another kind of terminal strip is the screw type. Now, and I put a terminal on there already, and I'll show you how to crimp the wire on that terminal here in a second. And all you have to do is just take your needle nose pliers and then just bring it around into a circle, just like that. You want to put this in the direction that you're tightening the screw. You just put it underneath there and then bring it around. And once you tighten the screw, it's going to tighten your wire up also. But you can see right there how it turns around in there. You could also do that with stranded wire, but it is much more difficult with stranded wire because the stranded wire will come apart as you're doing it. If you're going to use stranded wire, I would suggest tin it so you could manipulate it just like solid wire. This little connector right here that has the screws in it, and it's similar to this terminal strip, but it's made for circuit boards. And if you have small circuit boards or breakout boards with holes in them, you could use this in there and actually solder them on there. And these connectors have a little ridge on there, so you could slide more than just the two together. If you've been working with servo motors or hobby motors, then you may be familiar with this type of connector right here. This is what you normally get on a servo motor. And on the hobby motor, you have the little two pins on there, similar to the jumper wires that you use on a breadboard. Now, these are very simple. You just plug it in, and they are really good connectors. I don't have to show you too much about them. But it's usually on more delicate stuff and just the regular jumper wires or the standoffs that I showed you in another video, and I'll show it to you on here. But say you have a board. Now this is a relay board, but I'll just show you that these fit right on the pins just like that. on, if you're using a Arduino board or anything like that, they'll have them on top. Now we're going to talk about this kind of connector right here. Now, this is the kind of crimping tool that I have. They're made in many different styles. This is one of the styles that I have right here. When you're stripping your wire, you want to make sure that you strip it shorter than what the insulation is right here. So when you put it in there, you don't have any bare wire showing out the back. And if you do, you can push your wire in just a little bit so it shows through. It's not going to hurt. And what I do is, if you could see on there, there is a slot where the metal is folded over. I take my crimpers and I put the slot in the side that has the notch in it and just crimp down on it like that. It's not going to go anywhere. And then you could put this on your terminal strip right there like that. I hope with this demonstration you come out with a better understanding of the connectors that are available for use on your model railroad and how to use them. That's my intention, to show you how to make things better on your model railroad. So if you like what you see here and would like to contribute, go ahead and take a look at my Patreon account, patreon.com/TomKovichak, or paypal.me/TomsTrainsAndThings, where you can contribute to this channel, where I could give you better videos so you could make a better model railroad. Thank you very much for those of you who have contributed so far. I'm going to try to do a live show, at least two of them a month, either on Friday or Sunday. So I'll let you know ahead of time, but maybe on this Friday, it'll be coming up there. So take a look for that and we'll see you.